So the next, so we have so far what we have done is we have looked at point defects and we have discussed how why point defects exist in the first place in the materials, and then we have discussed line defects and what is the meaning of dislocation motion and how that and what is the meaning of plastic deformation in a material, and then we have discussed interfacial defects and what is the what are the different kinds of interface defects. And now the last module in this unit, imperfections, is strengthening mechanisms. So what do you mean by, so whenever you want your material science friend, the friend from metallurgical engineering, you want to discuss with him and have ask him to develop material which has a better strength, right? So immediately what happens, he will develop different alloys and he will say that I can increase the strength. But again you will go back and say that okay, you can increase the strength but I don't want to lose my ductility, right? So that is, you want good side of everything, right? You don't want to sacrifice your ductility for strength. But then your friend in metallurgical engineering will tell you, so I cannot do that, there should be a compromise. And as a mechanical engineer, you should be able to understand what he is talking about, right? And that is the reason why we need to learn these basics of material science. When you are talking to your friends in other departments, when you are in your real job, when you will be interacting with engineers from different disciplines, and you should be able to talk in the language that they can understand, and you should be able to understand the language in which they are talking, right? So that is why the strengthening mechanisms is an important aspect, particularly for mechanical engineers, because we want to design structures which have higher strength, but at the same time they are not brittle. So you will come up with a design and then say that okay, I want a material with such and such strength, and but the ductility should be reasonably good. But if you don't know that such material is not possible, your design is not going to be useful, right? And hence you should know why such systems are not possible, and if at all one can make such systems, what are the steps that one needs to take, right? So why a material gets strengthened when you do something to it? What are the different ways that I can enhance the strength of the material, right? So these are the aspects that we are going to study in this module. So in order to understand the concept of strengthening mechanisms, the most important thing for us to understand is the relationship between the dislocation motion and the mechanical behavior of the materials. The moment we understand these, the connection between the dislocation motion and the mechanical behavior, we sort of reasonably understand the various strengthening mechanisms that we are going to look at. So how do you strengthen a material? The basic principle is to restrict or hinder the dislocation motion. If you restrict the dislocation motion, then what happens? It becomes harder for you to impart plastic deformation, and as a result your yield strength of the material increases. That is what you mean by strengthening. So all that you need to do is just to restrict the dislocation motion, right? So by restricting the dislocation motion, you can actually make your material harder and stronger. So what are the different ways that you can do so? One of the ways that you can increase the strength of the material is by grain size reduction, solid solution strengthening, strain hardening or work hardening, particle hardening and strain gradient hardening. In this class we will be talking about only these three mechanisms, and these two mechanisms I suggest you go back and read in the textbooks that are available on mechanical behavior of materials, okay? All right. So first of all, we will talk about strengthening mechanisms due to grain boundaries, okay? First of all, grain boundary is, as we have discussed, is a defect in a crystalline material, right? So what is the implication of that defect to the dislocation motion? Let us say you have a grain A and grain B. In grain A, this is your slip plane,
and the dislocation is moving in this direction, that is the slip direction, that is your dislocation, right? This is your dislocation. Now, when you are applying shear stress, the dislocation moves in this direction, and the moment it encounters a grain boundary, then the slip, further slip is not possible because there is a misorientation. The neighboring grain is not having the same orientation, the slip plane is in the other direction, there is a orientation mismatch. And as a result, the dislocation simply cannot move past the grain boundary. Then what happens? The dislocation gets struck near the grain boundary. You are applying the stress, but the dislocation is not able to move forward across the grain boundary. And as a result, what happens? You will have the stress generation, because you are putting in the stress, right? So here you will have stress generation. So for some time, you will have a resistance to dislocation motion. That means suddenly you see that your force displacement curve, the force keeps on increasing without not so much increase in the strain, okay? And then because of the increase in the stress ahead of the grain boundary, the grain, neighboring grains slip system gets activated. And then if there are some dislocations, then the dislocations in this grain start moving and so on, right? So the atomic disorder within the grain boundary will result in discontinuity in the slip planes, and that is what hinders the dislocation motion. That is how you can actually stop the dislocation motion, okay? And usually the stress field, whenever you have a grain boundary like that, there is a misorientation, and there you will, because of the misorientation, you will create a local stress field around the dislocation, and that is usually proportional to the Burgess vector and the radius, dislocation core radius. All right. So if it is a high angle grain boundary, that means the misorientation is larger. If it is a low angle grain boundary, the misorientation is smaller. That means the slip plane on grain A and grain B are misoriented, but the difference in orientations is not so much. So if it is high angle grain boundary, the dislocation will not cut open the grain boundary and move. It will rather create higher stress in the neighboring grain boundary and creates a new dislocation motion in the neighboring grain boundary. But if it is a low angle grain boundary, it is possible sometimes for the dislocations to cut open the grain boundary and go into the neighboring grain. So these are the different mechanisms. But nevertheless, the mere presence of the grain boundary is actually creating obstruction to dislocation motion, eventually increasing the strength of the material. Are you able to see this? Yeah? Is that clear? Why the grain boundaries increase the strength of the material? And now, if you have a crystalline material, and now let us say that means if you have more grain boundary area within the material, that means there are more obstructions to dislocation motion, isn't it? If you increase the grain boundary area, you are increasing the probability of a dislocation getting impeded near the grain boundary. So one of the ways that you can increase the strength is by increasing the grain boundary area. How can you increase the grain boundary area? You take a material and reduce the grain size. If you reduce the grain size, you can actually put in more number of grains, and as a result, you will have more grain boundary area. Are you able to see that? So suppose if you have, this is your material, and let us say these are grain 1 and grain 2, okay? This is the grain boundary area. It is length, but of course, if you take out of plane, you will have the area. Now, if I want to increase the grain boundary area, what I can do is, I can make, instead of 2 grains, now I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 grains. So what happened? I have reduced the grain size. As a result, the total grain boundary area has increased. Yes. No, but it also depends on the moment you have an obstruction. So for instance, let us say in these multiple grains, you have a dislocation getting activated here. Okay, let us for the sake of argument, let us say only this location is getting activated here and this gets pinned here, gets obstructed there. And you are, and then this location cannot move past if it is high angle. Even if it is low angle grain boundary, it needs additional force in order to move past to the next guy. Then there are dislocations also in the next other slip, other materials, they also move. But if you imagine without any grain boundary, you have a dislocation here, you have a dislocation here, they have no they have no resistance, they are freely moving, alright, and hence you have a nice easy glide plastic deformation that is happening, alright. But when you have more grain boundaries, what happens is all of them cannot move easily. It is like this. Let us say you have a long bamboo stick, you are holding like this and you are running with this bamboo stick in KV grounds here. What happens? You will be happily able to run either KV grounds or our Manohar Vatsa stadium, you will be able to happily run. Now if I put you in the forest in the campus, then what happens? You are running with this long bamboo stick and running in the forest. What happens? Every time you will encounter a tree, and then what you need to do? You need to apply more force so that your stick bends and goes and you will be able to run. If your stick is strong enough and the tree is weaker, you can actually break open the tree and, right? If it cannot break open, then it will have to bend, otherwise it will. But nevertheless, if you increase, if there are only two trees, you will be able to break open and then move fast. But if there are so many trees in a real jungle, what happens? Every time you are trying to make a move, there is an obstruction. And then you have to apply more and more stress. As a result, with the smaller strain itself, your strength has increased significantly, right? And that is what is the strengthening mechanism that we are talking about. So the bottom line here is that if you reduce the size of the grain, you can increase the strength of the material, right? And yes. Wait, no, we did not say single crystal materials are harder. When did we say? Did I say that? I never said single crystal material is harder than polycrystalline material. We only said that single crystal materials are better for high temperature applications because the thermal creep, there is another deformation mechanism that is detrimental when you have grain boundaries. Because the grain boundaries are your defects, near the grain boundaries your thermal creep becomes a problematic thing, and hence you don't want to have grain boundaries there. But I did not say that single crystal material is stronger than a polycrystalline material, it is actually the other way around. Okay, am I, yeah, we have time. So when, so this is d power minus half, that means 1 by square root d as a function of yield strength of the material. This is for 70 copper, 30 zinc, a brass alloy. As you reduce the grain size, which direction are we moving on the x-axis? To the right it is smaller grain because it is 1 over square root d, right? Is that clear? Then your yield strength increases. As you reduce your grain size, the yield strength increases, and typically you can write the expression for yield strength as sigma naught plus ky times ky by root 2d, root d, sorry, ky by root d. So where d is the grain size, approximate grain size. And this equation is valid only for grains of certain size. It is not valid for coarse grains, and it is also not valid for extremely fine grains. So what this tells you, if you take this equation, what happens when your d is 0? If you take this equation for yield strength, what should happen when d is 0? You should have infinite yield strength. What do you mean by d equal to 0? there is no material, right? You are saying that if you take this equation, you can have infinite strength if you don't have a material at all. So that is contradicting, right? Obviously, this cannot work. This has a range within which it works, and the relation, the behavior that with the reduction in grain size, the yield strength of the material increases is given by this relation, and this is called Hall-Petch relation. Obviously, there is a limit. That is what we call Hall-Petch strengthening limit. Typically, of the order of your grain size being few nanometers, if you reduce the grain size initially, your dislocation slip mechanism comes into play, and as you are reducing the grain size, your yield strength increases, the blue line. But normally, if you use that Hall-Petch relation, it should continue to increase like that, but it will not do so. After some time, if the size of the grain is below say 10 nanometers, then another mechanism comes into play, and as a result, your yield strength decreases again. And this is what is called inverse Hall-Petch relation, inverse Hall-Petch. Why is that? Because if the grain size drops below the equilibrium distance between dislocations, this Hall-Petch relation breaks. That is, with the, that means with the reduction in grain size, grains will be of the size of the unit cell, which destroys the long range order, right? The grain itself is becoming of the size of the unit cell because you are reaching the size of the atom itself, and then there is no long range order at all, and hence it is not a crystalline material. The material itself is not crystalline anymore. So the deformation mechanism is going to be completely different. That is one way. Another thing is the grain boundary sliding. So the moment you are reducing the grains smaller and smaller, the grain boundaries start to slide, and that will become, that will make the material softer and softer instead of making it harder. Okay, so another mechanism is solid solution strengthening. That means you put in impurities in the material. For instance, if you are, this is your crystalline lattice, you put a small impurity, and that creates a local stress state around the crystalline lattice. If it is a small impurity, then it will create sort of tensile stress. If you put a larger impurity, then it will sort of create a compressive stress, and that local stress state will obstruct the dislocation motion. Like in the case of grain boundary, the moment you have a grain boundary, you have a local stress field created, and the dislocations interact with the local stress field, and that is what hinders the dislocation motion. Similarly, if you are an impurity, the impurities hinders dislocation motion, right? And the last one, which we have already discussed, so this is a typical material property landscape. When you increase the nickel content in a copper nickel system, your tensile strength increases, but after some time it again decreases. We have not shown the decrease part, because then it becomes solute and solvent are changing, so there will be a peak always, it cannot continue to increase. All right, now there is another mechanism which I have not written here, that is work hardening or strain hardening. So suppose this also happens in single crystal materials. The stage 2 is primarily due to work hardening in single crystal material. What is stage 2 deformation? In a single crystal material, we have stage 1, stage 2 and stage 3, right? Stage 1 was easy glide. Stage 2 is due to, we called it as work hardening. What is happening? Why do you call this as work hardening? By the time you are in stage 2, there are several dislocations. As you are increasing the load, your dislocation density in the material increases, and these dislocations start to interact with each other. So you have one dislocation and another dislocation, they are moving and they get locked. We have discussed about it, something called Lamer lock, and dislocations, opposite sign dislocations repel each other, and same size dislocations attract and they become perfect, and then there is no dislocation motion. And the dislocations entangling with each other, all these cause the work hardening in the material. That can also happen in the polycrystalline material too, right? And in the polycrystalline materials, typically the deformation mechanism is a little bit more complex. It is possible, if it is a polycrystalline material, you have one grain, another grain, you can have several slip systems active at the same time in each of the grains, right? And hence, at the same time, these dislocations are looking at the grain boundary. The moment they move, immediately they try to see the grain boundaries or some impurities. And as a result, you will not have this easy glide. It is extremely difficult to observe easy glide, or you may not observe easy glide that you have observed in single crystal material in case of polycrystalline materials, because of the numerous grains and random crystallographic orientations, and these things are interacting with each other. And as a result, polycrystalline materials are usually stronger because there are more obstructions than the single crystal counterparts. Okay, this is a typical micrograph of a polycrystalline material which is deformed plastically. So these serrations are your slips that are happening in the material, right? Slip system 1, slip system 2, and so on. All right, so work hardening I have discussed. And in addition to hardening mechanisms, you will also have several softening mechanisms, which I am not going to discuss in this class. You please go through that in the material. You can also have material getting softened, just not hardened. Okay.